evening. If you're thinking, wow, he's doing awful good after a back operation, I didn't, they postponed it. I was actually on the operating table and they couldn't go forward because of issues with my neck. And they want to do two operations instead of one. Right now, I don't want to do any. So, if you want to pray for me, just pray God will heal me and we'll be done with it. Which would be great, right? So, tonight, we are going to be in 2 Corinthians 5. The Sunday before this past Sunday, we talked about being a new creation, that God makes those who believe in Christ new creations, and how everything changes the moment we believe. So we had talked about our identification with Christ, how through it we receive a new identity, in contrast to what the world's view of personal identity. They try to create an identity from arbitrary things. So this tonight, Paul is going to move on. We'll be in verses 18 through 21, the last four verses of the chapter. And after Paul identifies what being a new creation is and tells the Corinthians that, he moves on to the ministry of reconciliation that is connected to that. So let's read verses 18 through 21, and then we'll pray. And so remember, this Saturday at 3 p.m., we have our Christmas Eve service. The office will be open an hour or so prior to the service, hour and a half. And, you know, if you need anything, and other than that, the rest of this week, Thursday and Friday, the office and bookstore is closed. If you need something, please call and leave a message. We'll call you back. We get the messages forwarded to us. And same thing with next week. The church office will be closed next week. There is no Bible study youth group Awana next Wednesday evening, just tonight. And then we'll be back in service on January 1st, 2023. I can remember when 2000 was the big deal, right? Y2K, everybody was going to die and the planes were going to explode. So we're still here. So we'll read. Verse 18, Paul says, coming out of this conversation about being a new creation, he says, now all things are of God, who has reconciled us to himself through Jesus Christ, and has given us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, that God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself, not imputing their trespasses to them, and has committed to us the word of reconciliation. Now then, we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God were pleading through us. We implore you, on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. For he made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. So let's pray. Father, we ask that you would open our hearts to these verses tonight, that you would encourage us, that your word would go forth in edification, exhortation, and comfort, and that you would just give us, Lord, direction. We all need direction, Lord, whether we actually realize it or not. And I just pray, Father, that you would not only be with us, that Jesus would be glorified, and that your Spirit would open our hearts to your word. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. So, as Paul talked about in the previous few verses to this that we talked about basically a couple of weeks ago, not the door is open. I hear screaming kids. Once we're a new creation, we actually have an obligation to share this life-changing message of reconciliation to others. That's what Paul is basically getting into here. Now, since all are dead, which Paul tells us in verse 14, he says the love of Christ constrains us because we thus judge that if one died for all, then all were dead. So Paul concludes that Jesus died for all. In other words, he died for everybody that was dead, and that was everybody, right? dead in their trespasses and sins. Obviously, they were walking around. But the key subject of this paragraph is the word reconciliation. And man is in rebellion and has become an enemy of God. And so he is out of fellowship with God. Through the work on the cross, Christ has brought man into a place where he can actually be reconciled to God, because God has been reconciled and has turned his face now to a lost world. So we sometimes get the idea that, you know, because God is angry at sin and, you know, he is contrary in his nature and his character to the corruption in the world, that he's just really angry at everybody. Well, God actually loves everybody. We get angry at everybody, but and God is, it says in the Psalms, he's angry with the wicked every day, and that is true. He does not approve of their behavior. But Christ died for those wicked people. He died for us when we were wicked. Same thing. So God has been reconciled himself to the world through the cross. So reconciliation refers to a changed relationship between God and the lost world. So God doesn't have to be reconciled to us because that was accomplished on the cross, but it's sinful man who must now be reconciled to God. In other words, from God's side, it's been taken care of, but man needs to respond. The work is done, and now it's a message going forth of reconciliation, which brings us really to verse 18, where we started. So again, Paul talking about we're a new creation in Christ, old things have passed away, everything has become new, and he says in verse 18, now all things are of God, who has reconciled us to himself through Jesus Christ, and has given us the ministry of reconciliation. So when he says all things are of God, that tells us the all things are of the new creation, the work that God has done in us to bring us in Christ. And that's all accomplished by God, not us. In other words, I didn't put myself in Christ. God did. I didn't convict myself of sin. God did, the Holy Spirit. I didn't ask Jesus to go to the cross. That was God's plan. I didn't come up with any of this. I just came up with the sinning part and the rebellion. So God did all the work. He planned the whole thing so that he could then offer freely to us salvation. Salvation just means deliverance. We would be delivered from a number of things. We'd be delivered from eternal punishment. We'd be delivered from the penalty of sin, the power of sin, and eventually in glory, the presence of sin. It's deliverance from a number of things. Salvation encompasses a number of things that we are delivered from. So, like God did in the first creation, where he created the universe, had nothing to do with us. The new creation is also initiated by God. In other words, if God had not done everything necessary to provide the salvation for mankind, it really wouldn't matter what mankind did. They could not be saved. There's nothing they could do. You know, they could try to offer something to God, but if God did not provide the way, there would be no way. Now, Paul goes on, he says, who has reconciled us to himself through Jesus Christ. In other words, Christ's death on the cross makes possible man's reconciliation to God, but it doesn't make it happen automatically. That's not how it works. So we respond to God by faith, which is trust. That's, faith is trust, right? To the offer of God through the gospel. When we respond, that makes what is potentially there for us actual. You know, we have electrical outlets around the building here, So we have the potential of getting electricity in the outlet. We don't get it until you plug something in. Well, salvation is offered to all. Everybody is savable, but they need to plug in. Well, how do you do that? You have faith. You trust God that He has accomplished what was necessary to secure our salvation and rescue us from an eternity in hell. And once we do that, we're engaging. one of the things that I think that sometimes people get confused when we talk about faith and work, the reason that God requires faith or trust is because work cannot develop a relationship. I mean, I can hire you, not even know your name, and you can do works to benefit me and for me, but I have no idea who you are. You can't have a relationship that is founded on work, right? I could do all kinds of things for God, but that never addresses the actual issue, which is my sin. Because I can't, by doing things, make the sin nature I have go away. It'll never happen. We'll get into that. But trust. You know, when you enter a relationship with somebody, there's trust. You know, when I met my wife and we started dating, I had to trust that she was who she was telling me that she was. And she had to trust me that I was being honest with her about who I was and, you know, what I was all about as a person. Because you end up falling in love with the person that is being presented to you. The character of the person, what they're all about. And that's why it's so devastating when there are relationships and people say, well, this is really what I'm all about. And then people find out, they just lied to them the whole time. Well, that's that kind of betrayal is crippling to a relationship. So relationships are based on trust. Now, when I trust in Christ, I'm trusting that God sent Him, God's only Son, that He sent Him on a mission to rescue me from my sin. I'm trusting God is being honest with me about that. Now, obviously, you know, we go through a lot of the evidences of that, but in trusting that, I enter into an actual relationship with God. I can't do that based on work. I can say, oh, that's great. Thanks for sending your son. Now, I'm going to do this, and all these things for you. You know, but that has nothing to do with relationship. That's why when we talk about serving God, we say relationship is the foundation, and then your work of service to God comes after you know Him, after you've trusted Christ, and it is the normal outgrowth of that. You know, I mean, I do things that I know please my wife, but I don't do them because I get up every morning and she has a list and says, you know, I'll like you if you do this, and this today. That wouldn't be much of a relationship. Because it would just be like I might as well get paid for it and be an indentured servant. Because it has nothing to do with a relationship. Now, if she says, will you do this, in response, I do that because I love her and I trust her. I have a relationship with her. So having a relationship is always based in trust. And that's sometimes what confuses people as they read the Bible, because the Bible does talk about work. It does talk about, kind of for Christians to kick it into gear at times. But that is not what creates a relationship. That is the normal outgrowth of the relationship. Because if you don't really know God, who are you serving? You're serving somebody in a, you know, far off distance that you have no idea who they are. There's no heart, there's no love, there's no actual relationship there. So we respond by faith to enter into a relationship with God through Christ, and that makes what is potentially there for our forgiveness and justification, it makes it actual. That's when it gets applied to our life. And then we're placed in Christ by the Holy Spirit, right? 1 Corinthians 12:13, for by one Spirit we're baptized into the body of Christ. And that's through the gospel. Now, what's the gospel? Well, the gospel, which means good news, is the offer. It's the message that goes out to be reconciled to God. That's effectively the message of the gospel. So reconciliation is really a term that Paul develops more than anybody, and he uses it to explain how man is at enmity with God and can be brought back into a proper relationship. So enmity is hostility, it's hatred, you know, you're against somebody, you're at war with them in a sense. Now, the word reconciliation is closely aligned with the word atonement. And atonement means to cover through sacrifice. And it's also connected to the word that Paul uses in John, which is the word propitiation, which means satisfaction. So, you know, in 1 John it says that Christ is the propitiation for our sins. To propitiate somebody is, or propitiate someone is to satisfy them. So the sacrifice of Christ propitiated God in the sense that Christ's sacrifice was fully adequate to pay for the sins that everybody has committed, which then renders everybody savable, right? They're in the potential position to be saved. For example, in Matthew 5:24, on the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus said, "Leave your gift there before the altar and go your way. First be reconciled to your brother, and then come and offer your gift." Now, obviously, he's talking about people under the law. When he says be reconciled to your brother, it means propitiate him, satisfy him. In other words, give him what is necessary to satisfy the anger or the hostility that is there between you and your brother so that you can be reconciled. And so the word is actually propitiate him. So reconciliation is closely connected and sometimes is translated by English translators as either atonement or propitiation. So reconciliation basically is a restoration of an original understanding between two people anyways after there's hostility or displeasure. So you get into a, you know, an argument, a disagreement with somebody. Well, you know, we try to bring people into reconciliation. We want the enmity or the hostility to be satisfied, removed out of the way so that the relationship can be there. So the restoration of the relationship between God and man is only through the sacrifice for sin that propitiates or satisfies God and enables man to be restored. And that is only possible because the sin that has caused the problem has been atoned for. And that's only through the cross. So, as we proclaim the message of the gospel to people, that's the intention that we're trying to get across. We're trying to get across the fact that God, you know, has done all the work. You just need to trust Christ. And the reconciliation is through the gospel message, which is why Paul says God gave the apostles the ministry of reconciliation. They were the forerunners to bring this out in the New Testament in the book of Acts, with the result of the gospel being people coming to Christ. They were reconciled back to God. Now, the Bible tells us that man needs to be reconciled to God because he's naturally alienated from God in his mind in evil works, it says in Colossians 1:21. And Paul tells us in Romans 8:7 that the mind of the flesh, and that is the the thinking process that is driven by our sin nature, which we will have until we get our glorified bodies. The mind of the flesh is enmity against God, or hostility. It's hostile against God. This is the enmity that the carnal heart needs to overcome. So I have a, you know, God has given me a new heart, but I still am plagued by my old nature. You know, I have, in a sense, two natures. So the old nature, the sinful nature I inherited from Adam, bothers me constantly because it cannot align itself with God. It's at war with God. It's hostile against Him. It doesn't want to do what God says to do. It doesn't want to be under any authority. It doesn't want to do anything. I mean, the kind of craziness you're seeing in the culture, that is the manifestation of sin nature. That's the end result of it in society. People just do what they want to do. They're out of control. Everything is entirely self-centered and absorbed, self-absorbed. So people will only do what they want to do, when they want to do it, the way they want to do it, and nobody can tell them any differently. That is the normal manifestation of the sin nature. When the Holy Spirit gives us the power to walk in the new nature that we have, the one that is freed from that sin nature, then all of a sudden we can be focused on Christ, we can be other-centered, we can actually love people that don't love us. You know, there's a whole manifestation that comes out in an opposite way. So that's kind of the battle that is going on inside of us. Now, even after we're believers, carnal thinking still has to be overcome by the work of the Holy Spirit in our life. In other words, you know, we talked when we were talking about being a new creation that in Romans 6, if you think about a car engine, the engine's running. When we were united to Christ in His death and resurrection, we're in Christ, we died with Christ, we raised again. Now, obviously, we didn't go back 2,000 years. But God placed us in Christ, so the effect of laws and, you know, the law of God and the power and penalty of sin has been removed, because when somebody dies, you don't still bring them to court, prop them up in a chair, and then say guilty. There's nothing to apply against them. Well, when Jesus paid for my sin on the cross, in past, He paid for the penalty. In present, He broke the power. So I'm not only freed from the penalty of my sin, which is judgment, but I am freed from the power of sin. So the car is running. It's still the sin nature, but it's in neutral. Okay? I can put it in drive, but I don't have to put it in drive. But I have the potential to put it in drive. My sin nature wants to put it in drive all the time. But the Holy Spirit enables me to not put it in drive when I would like to. So when we sin, I mean, obviously, it's just such a part of our nature that it's really impossible to avoid. Even though you may not do sinful things or think sinful things, you can have a sinful attitude. I mean, it's almost like we can't escape it. We can't escape ourselves. So that's why Jesus had to pay for all that, because if it was up to us to somehow straighten ourselves out, we'd all be doomed. It would not work. Even after you get saved, if God said, okay, took care of all your sins, now don't sin anymore or you won't go to heaven, I'm done. Even as a Christian, I can't live like that. Nobody can make that, you know, that bar. It's just too high. So that's why Jesus took care of the whole thing. And that's why your future in glory is already talked about as being a done work in the book of Romans. So it's important that we understand that God didn't leave us, like, He didn't just kind of break the power and kind of leave us in neutral. He gave us the power of the Holy Spirit to not put it in drive. And the power of the Holy Spirit then moves in our lives that we actually start going in a direction that is pleasing to God, that can glorify Christ, and all of a sudden it's like we have this new life that we're living. Now, prior to coming to faith in Christ, we were all under God's wrath. We were objects of God's wrath, it tells us in Romans 1:18, and we were under condemnation, it says in Romans 3:19. But that stuff has to be removed. So it means that God removes us from that place of condemnation and wrath by reconciliation. When he reconciles us to himself, which we complete the transaction by faith, then we are entering into the ministry of reconciliation for ourselves to receive it. But we actually need to understand what it is so that we can also present it to other people. So verse 19, he says, that is, in other words, this reconciliation ministry is, that God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself, not imputing their trespasses to them, and has committed to us the word of reconciliation, in other words, the words of the gospel. So man has his sin atoned for or covered or removed, right? And God is propitiated, he's justly satisfied by the sacrifice of Christ. And then the reconciliation process is all set up for both sides because the cross is the only means. There is no other way. So God doesn't sweep the sin under the rug and say, well, we just won't look over there. He righteously and justly paid the cost of it himself in Christ. It was taken care of. So the price for man's redemption was only paid at the cross through that atonement, which is why, like, doing work, it has no effect because it can't atone for any sins. Peter said in 1 Peter 1:18, knowing that you were not redeemed with corruptible things like silver or gold from your aimless conduct received by the tradition of your fathers, but with the precious blood of Christ, as of a lamb without blemish and without spot. You know, nobody gave any money for you to go to heaven. It doesn't work like that. In a different way, Paul says the same thing. In Romans 5, he says, for when we were without strength, in due time Christ died for the ungodly. That's me. For scarcely for a righteous man would one die, yet perhaps for a good man someone would even dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love toward us in that while we were still sinners in our hostility against God, Christ died for us. Much more then, having now been justified by his blood, we shall be saved from wrath, that condemnation that we were under, through him. For if when we were enemies, we were reconciled to God through the death of his Son, much more, having been reconciled, we shall be saved by his life. In other words, the resurrection from the dead freed us from the power of death. And not only that, but we also rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received, the old King James says, the atonement. The new King James says the reconciliation, because they are really extensions of the same word. That's how closely tied they are. So sinners, they owe for their own sin. And if you owe for your own sin, you got nothing to pay for somebody else. And if you want to pay for your own sin, that's what you pay in hell. So if you don't, you know, you don't want to come to Christ, then it's like, okay, you can pay for your sin. But the only way to do that, because we've sinned against an eternal being, is to pay an eternal death, an eternal separation. You know, it's not temporary, it's eternal. You know, and some people say, well, why would we have to suffer for eternity, you know, for something that happens in just like this short amount of time? And
I mean, look, you can murder somebody in about 2 seconds. And then the sin's done with. And but you go to jail for the rest of your life or go to the electric chair. It's because of the type of offense it is. And to offend the creator of the universe, who is holy and just, right, separate from all corruption and everything, he's an eternal being. So it's not like you can just sin in time and then come on in. You know, you guys are good guys. It doesn't work like that because he would be unjust at that point. He would be against his own nature. So hell is the place that God has made originally for angels that rebelled. And that's the same quarantine that's going to be for people that don't want Christ to pay for their sins. They'll pay for their own. So reconciliation is a work of God that we receive, right? Not something that we initiate or create. When it said God was in Christ, where Paul said this, it means two things. First, God was in Christ, meaning the fullness of deity, that Jesus was fully God and fully man. God dwelt in the body of Christ. That's in Colossians 2:9. Second, it means God was in Christ doing the work and paying the price of redemption. In other words, Jesus was not an ordinary man, right? He's the only God-man that could make reconciliation possible because he can touch both God and man and bridge that gap. That's why he needed to be God in human flesh, fully God and fully man. So he's the only one that is, he is one person with two natures, which is why you always have to ask when people say, well, why did Jesus get tired if he was God? Well, he gets tired in his human nature. He gets tired in his divine nature. He never ceased to be God. He took on a human nature. He added it. And in doing that, he could then die. Obviously, you can't die as God. So he had to take on humanity, become one of us, right? Become a Goel, a kinsman redeemer, so that he could then be one of us and pay for us. He was related to us by human family. So because he could touch both God and man, nobody else could do that. No sinner could effectively do that. So Paul goes on, he says, not imputing their trespasses to them, meaning the reconciliation removed the barrier to our salvation. But it doesn't make salvation, as I said earlier, automatic. God brings everybody into a savable relationship with him by sending Christ to pay for the penalty of their sin. But the fact that God has reconciled from his side man doesn't mean that man is automatically saved. Man has to respond. Relationships are two-way. They're not just one way, right? So God's not going to hunt down a bunch of people that don't want to be in heaven and say, you're coming to heaven whether you like it or not, because it's based in relationship. So the word impute, he doesn't impute their sins against them. Impute is a word Paul uses a number of times, and it means to put to one's account. It's a banking term. If I impute money to your bank account, it means I'm putting money in your bank account. Well, what he does is he puts the righteousness of Christ into our account. We have no righteousness on our own. We have filthy rags. So what God does when we come to Christ, he provides the righteousness of Christ. Why is that important? Because it's only the righteousness of Christ that's allowed in heaven. So when Jesus raised up from the dead, it meant that his sacrifice was accepted. When Jesus ascended into heaven, it meant that his righteousness was the only kind of righteousness, which is perfection, that is allowed in the presence of God. So, to be in Christ means I'm going there entirely on his merit, and I can survive God's presence because I'm in Christ. I can't survive it in my own nature. It'd be like getting too close to the sun. You just burn up. So reconciliation is based on imputation, right? That God imputes this righteousness to me because the demands of God's law have been fully met on the cross by Christ, and then God can be reconciled to all of us sinners. So God doesn't impute sins to man because his justice is what? It's propitiated. It's satisfied. So sin isn't excused. It's propitiated. Now, interesting, the word propitiation is the same word in the Greek Old Testament for mercy seat. Now, what the mercy seat was, the top of the Ark of the Covenant, where the blood was put by the high priest once a year when he went into the Holy of Holies by himself. And, you know, he had the basin with the blood, moving it to not coagulate, and he dipped the hyssop bush in there and sprinkled it on there. And that was the place where God's mercy met his justice. He allowed the atoning blood to, for another year, cover over the sins of the nation of Israel so that he could relate with them. It didn't save them. It made them so that they could have fellowship with God. Everybody is always saved by faith. They're not saved by works in the Old Testament, and then faith in the New. From Adam to the millennial reign, people are only saved by faith. Nobody is ever saved by work. So, once we trust Christ, there's no sins that are held against us, because they were imputed to Christ. When his righteousness was imputed to me and I'm placed in Christ, my sins are imputed to him. He paid for them on the cross. I'll never pay for them again. And the message can now go forth to everybody to be reconciled to God. That is the good news. That's the gospel, right? That people can be reconciled. That's the Christmas message, right? Luke 2, the angel came and said, you know, I bring you good tidings. Good news, right, of great joy, which will be to who? To all people, right? For there is born to you this day in the city of David a Savior who is Christ the Lord. So that's the Christmas message, you know. It's wrapped around the gospel. So now we get to verse 20. It says, now then, we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God were pleading through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. Now, when he says we are ambassadors, it's not that we should be ambassadors for Christ, not for ourselves or other causes. We are. Once we're saved, we are now ambassadors for Christ, whether we want to be or not. In other words, we present to the world this country that we belong to, that is heaven, right? Paul says your citizenship is in heaven, he wrote to the Philippians. So I represent, like, what in the world is a foreign place, obviously, to the world. And so I'm representing something entirely different than what is here on earth. So, unfortunately, many times Christians don't represent Christ in an honorable fashion, which means they're misrepresenting what heaven is all about. And Paul uses this concept to teach that we're to represent God's kingdom that has not yet come to earth, and implore the world that God did this work on their behalf. In other words, you know, like, this is good news. It's like, you know, you don't have to be separated from God. Now, obviously, I know that people, you know, think the message, a lot of it's nuts, but it doesn't change what we need to tell them. In other words, the truth is still the truth. If, you know, if somebody says, you know what, I don't even believe in gravity anymore, we don't say, well, we don't want to offend them, so let them step off the building. Oh, they'll learn real quick. They'll kill themselves, right? So, you know, you still got to tell people the truth. And, you know, you can only kind of soft-pedal it so much, you know. I mean, the thing that people don't like about the good news is that they have to recognize that they're sinners in need of a Savior. and, you know, people are being conditioned, you know, really, since Adam was put out of the garden, that they don't need God. You know, they can do it on their own. So it can be a difficult message to get across, but that doesn't change the message. So the gospel is to the lost, very simply for them to believe and delivered from eternal judgment. Now, Paul wasn't trying to get the Corinthians saved because he was telling them this. They already were saved. He was explaining the ministry of reconciliation and its connection to the gospel because the Corinthians were in danger of being a really bad witness in Corinth. They had fighting going on. They were listening to false teachers. They were a very confused group. And Paul was trying to kind of get them back to ground zero so that they could understand what their responsibility was. And so he makes this plea using the knowledge that the hearers had, the Corinthians, as a starting place to preach the gospel. Now, it's interesting. Paul always tried to find some common ground to share the truth, especially the gospel. In the book of Acts, in Acts 14:15, he said to the heathen that didn't really know any scripture. I mean, you know, you got to realize when Paul was going out on his first missionary journey, he was going into these pagan areas. No, nobody knew who Jesus was. Nobody really knew much about, you know, Israel, other than the fact that they were Jews. They were a different ethnic group that had, you know, strange laws and food requirements and things. Because some towns, you know, had a small contingent of Jews that may live there. And some of these towns around Asia Minor maybe didn't have many Jews at all. So it wasn't like all the pagans were really educated. They just knew the Jews kind of kept to themselves, did their own thing. So all of a sudden, Paul comes, you know, kind of a Jew, and then he's telling all these pagans, he's trying to explain the gospel to them that they need a Savior. I mean, they don't even necessarily believe in God, or, you know, maybe they believe in multiple gods, which a lot of people in the Roman Empire did. You know, they had their, you know, their list of gods no different than, you know, the Egyptians and the Greeks. And so he knew that there was one thing that they could understand, and that is nature. God has put nature there for us to connect people that know nothing about the Bible. So these pagans that knew nothing about the Bible, Paul connected with them through his discussion about nature. He says in Acts 14:15, he said, "Turn from these useless things," talking about the idols, "to the living God who made the heaven, the earth, the sea, and all that is in them." So Paul is saying, look, like, these idols aren't going to do anything for you. You need the God that's alive, that made everything, right? You know, I mean, David, Psalm 19, right? "The heavens declare the glory of God, the firmament," you know, "the atmosphere shows his handiwork, all the design and everything within our, you know, within our world. Day into day it utters speech, night into night it shows knowledge. There's no speech nor language. Their voice, where their voice is not heard, their line goes out to the world, and their message, in a sense, where people can see to the end of the earth." Everybody can see that God created everything. Didn't get there on its own. Can't. Doesn't work. So Paul explains the reason for the connection that he makes with heathens in, or pagans, in Romans 1:19. He says, "For his invisible attributes," talking about God, "namely his eternal power and divine nature, have been clearly perceived ever since the creation of the world in the things that have been made," creation. "So they are without excuse." People don't have excuse. Here's the reason that people don't have excuse when they look at creation. Because Paul is talking about working from effect back to cause. So something happens, police departments, detectives, law enforcement agencies, fire departments, when there's a fire and they got to investigate, nobody knows the cause from the beginning unless there's an eyewitness. You have to have the effects, the evidence of effect. and you work back to the cause. Everybody has to do that. When a bomb explodes, when they had the bomb go off in Boston, at the marathon, they had to get the pieces to know what kind of bomb it was. They understood by the effect what the cause was after their investigation. So we have to do that in life. Everything works like that. You get hit in the back of the head with a snowball, that's the effect. It's not the cause. You have to turn around to see who threw it. So it's the same thing in creation. Everything in creation, we have the effect. We have the effect of the universe. We have the effect of all the living systems that we have, in our atmosphere and everything. And so we look at that, which is the effect, and we work back to the cause. And when you get back to the cause, you have an infinite being that's beyond time, space, and matter that has the intelligence, the power, the will, and a number of other attributes necessary to do something like that. That's how they do science. Science is a search for causes. So we know the effects of things, but we got to figure out what the cause of those are. So Paul is using that argument in Romans 1. He says, for people that don't know the Bible, you use creation because creation is the effect. It doesn't get there on its own. Now, obviously, with evolutionists and everything else, they're coming up with some crazy causes that don't work. You can't get life from non-life. If I have a rock in my hand and a human being in the other, saying that, well, given enough time, this rock will be this person, well, it's ridiculous. Because nothing in the world of science would tell us that. Because we know that human life can never have a rock as a cause. And, by the way, where'd the rock come from? It had to come from somewhere. All the rocks in the universe had to come from somewhere. They didn't just make themselves. So this is what Paul is dealing with here. Now, to the Jews, he used the Old Testament because they knew it. In Acts 17:3, it says, and Paul reasoned with them from the Scriptures, the Old Testament, explaining and proving that it was necessary for Christ to suffer and to rise from the dead. So he went through all the prophetic areas of the Old Testament to demonstrate that Jesus of Nazareth was the right one. To the Greeks, he used reason. In Acts 17:29, it says, he actually draws on information that they would know from their own poets. He says, as even some of your own poets have said, for we are all his offspring. That's the quote. He says, being then God's offspring, we ought not to think that the divine being, God, is like gold or silver or stone, an image formed by the art and imagination of men. Because they were worshiping all these idols. He picked one that said to the unknown God. They had an idol there, and because they didn't want to, offend a God that they may not know that's out there. So Paul used that, and he said, hey, this God that you don't know, I'm going to tell you all about him. And that's what he did. So he reasoned with them in that way, but he had to reason based on what they could understand. Now, what we can do today in bridging the gap in people's knowledge is bring them where they need to go. That's what we do with, like, apologetics and stuff like that. We use it when it's needed. Now, if I was talking to somebody that was not saved, that kind of knew some stuff about the Bible and Jesus, well, I don't have to get into a whole apologetic argument as to, God's existence and he created it. Like, they may even believe that stuff, right? And now it's a matter of just helping them understand they can't work their way to God. They have to come by faith. So they may have some of the basics down. But if you have somebody that knows nothing, well, if, telling an atheist that God sent his son, he said, well, I don't even believe there is a God. How can he send his son? So we need to clear that out of the way. And that's what apologetics is about. We can do that by asking questions. So, if people have objections, when you're trying to share the gospel with them, we have to ask them a question, like what their objections are about, right? Why do they believe what they believe? Like, ask them to define their beliefs. A lot of times, when I've asked people to define why they believe what they believe and ask them to define their terms, they quickly understand that they're not sure what they believe. You know, some years back, we had a kid, some local kid, came into the bookstore, wanted to talk to a pastor. I was here, so I went up and started talking to him. And he was an atheist and getting into all this kind of crazy stuff. And I said, well, what do you mean you're an atheist? So he starts telling me, and I said, well, what's your basis for that? Like, why do you believe you're an atheist? Like, what evidence do you have that tells you you should be an atheist? Now, he was having trouble actually defining his atheism. And he said, well, I'm an atheist because of evolution. I believe in evolution. And I said, well, what do you mean by evolution? Well, we evolved. I said, I know, but what does that mean, though? Like, give me some definition so I understand what you think. He couldn't give me one. I said, I can give you the textbook definition. It may help you. But the problem is that he really didn't know what he believed. He just knew some words. So the words connected him with a group of people that he was comfortable with that didn't want to believe in God. So that means, okay, atheism, evolutionist, you know, blah, blah, blah. And then it's like, okay, so I can connect with the words. It puts me in the group, gives me some friends. And then all of a sudden, but I don't really know what it is. Now, some people think they know what it is. But as soon as you start asking somebody very nicely, well, but, like, why do you believe that? And if they can tell you, they'd say, what evidence do you have? You have to have evidence for stuff. I mean, Christianity is an evidence-based faith, not blind. If an atheist had said, well, I think eventually they're going to figure out how nature really kind of created everything. Everything came from nature. Well, that's not even possible. Because you can't get nature from nature. If nature doesn't exist, how is it going to create itself? Can't do it. You know? As one guy says, if you give me enough time, that's like saying, I'll convince you that I gave birth to my own mother. They're out of sequence. You can't do it. So nature can never just create nature because nature doesn't exist to create itself. It's very simple stuff. What that is, from an atheist standpoint, is nothing but blind faith. There's no evidence for it. There's no evidence for it until you can work effect back to cause. And that's what we do with Christianity. So a lot of times objections are just emotional with people, right? And then you can ask them at a certain point, have you considered Christianity, the cross and the resurrection, right? Most times, people don't believe in Christ, not because the evidence isn't there, but because they don't want to. They just don't want God to be there, and they don't want to deal with it. That's the majority of the time. People are not, you know, driving to the hoop trying to figure out what the real truth is in life. People do what they want to do, and then they find something that aligns with their wants. So then they're comfortable with that. And some people become Buddhists because they can feel spiritual, but then live the way they want. So if we can clear away the confusion, we can present the gospel effectively. And that's really what apologetics is about. But at Christmas time, it can be difficult. But it's a great opportunity for asking questions and to begin conversations. Like, Christmas and Easter are the best times for witnessing. I mean, all year long is, but, you know, if you're creative. But people are already kind of dealing with it. Even if they're just dealing with the, you know, the commercialization of Christmas and stuff. You know, I mean, like, just asking somebody, do you think everybody that celebrates Christmas believes in Jesus? You know? Good opening question. right? And if they say, well, I don't think so, say, well, why not? Well, because people probably don't. Do you? Right? You can work your way there quickly. Do you think people that celebrate Christmas know why God sent his son into the world?
I don't know. I mean, you know, like Christmas cards that, you know, they'll give you something.
Say, but, you know, then you can explain, and then you can ask, well, do you know why God sent his son? Asking questions is the best way to present the gospel because it tells you where they're coming from and what their barriers are. Do you think God actually had his son born in Bethlehem? If they don't,
no, I don't. I think that's just stuff on Christmas cards.
Well, what would you use to support your view that he wasn't born in Bethlehem? See, it's just like you can very quickly get to the end of somebody's ability to actually answer a question, and then you can present, gives you an opportunity to share, present the gospel. So verse 21, Paul says, for he made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. So he made him. So God had to make the one that was sinless sin. There was no other way to impute the sin to Christ. He had to put the sin on him so that the righteousness could come on us that believe. For us, right? For us means he was our substitute. He was in our place, right? He took our place and became the sin that we are, right? So there's no other way for us to become righteous with the perfect righteousness of Christ, obviously, than to have it imputed by faith. There's no other way to get it. He says that he might become. So it's not determined that everybody will believe, but it reveals that people can believe, that we might become, right? So this is the work of God that basically he had the sinless Messiah do on the cross, with the result that we could become the very righteousness. Now note, it says righteousness of God in him. That's key. It's only in Christ. There's no other way, which we keep repeating. So there is, look, there's reality that people live by, and then there's what people perceive as reality. The reality is that people feel they can be accepted by God because they do something good and they feel good about themselves. But the truth is that they can only be accepted in Christ. It doesn't matter how I feel. I can feel great. Everything can be going wonderful. And I can think, this is just the best. You know, God must love me. I'm just the best guy, right? People can talk themselves into anything. And look, there's various religions. They tell people they're heaven-bound for a myriad of reasons. But it's not through Christ. And people, you know, they try to get spiritual through meditation and all this other stuff. It's none of that is going to take away a person's sin. And some people think, well, no, I got this private agreement between me and God. We got this thing going. I'm okay with him. He knows, you know. But God's in the business of kind of, you know, working a little negotiation tactic to get them into heaven. Doesn't work. Not possible. It's really the religion of Cain, right? You want to come to God your own way, like Cain did. So there's no other means of acceptance. And apart from Christ, we don't have our own righteous standing. It's filthy work, as Isaiah tells us. But look, God was motivated by love, and then he says that he saved us by grace. By grace meaning there was no just cause. There was nothing in me. It was because he freely offered it, and he sent his son. So the merit for the righteousness that we receive is entirely on Christ. By standing before God, like we started off, it says it's all of God. That's my standing. The plan, the fulfillment, right? and now the offer of reconciliation. So it's received by faith alone. In another place, you know, we know Ephesians 2, 8 and 9, for by grace you've been saved through faith, and that salvation is not of yourselves, it's a gift of God, not of works, lest anyone should boast. So the only boasting that's going to be in heaven is going to be to the praise and the glory of God through the work of Christ and what he's done. So the message of reconciliation is to be carried and proclaimed by the ambassadors of heaven, that's us, from the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. He's given us the task. So we're ambassadors for Christ. This tells the world that they need reconciliation. So, look, God sends us because he is trying to make peace, not war, right? Be reconciled to God, Paul says. We represent Christ. And if sinners reject us and the message of the gospel, it's really Jesus that they're rejecting. We're just, you know, like G.K. Morgan says, we're just errand boys. We're just delivering a message. I didn't create the message. I didn't do anything. I'm just giving it to people. That's all we are. So what a privilege to be an ambassador of heaven to people in the world, but what a responsibility to present not just the information of the gospel, but the attitude of the gospel with people that are lost. It's easy to lose sight of that mission sometimes because we get treated lousy, but our goal is reconciliation at this point, not judgment. Judgment is coming. And when people die without Christ, obviously, you know, their destiny is sealed at that point. And people that are alive, when the tribulation starts, again, the wrath of God is going to come down. So, but right now is not that time. Right now is the time where we can offer them peace. And God has not declared war on the world quite yet. At the cross, he declared that he wants to have peace with man. Wants to bring man into a right relationship. So if anything, the world is really at war with God, even though he reaches out in love. So like I said, one day he's going to wage war, but then it's going to be too late, and we have an opportunity this Christmas at least to deliver that message. So, hey, it's the only way to make enemies friends, right? If they come to Christ. You know, you look at people that aren't saved and the things they do, and it's like, aggravating, right? Why are they doing that? But it's because they're not saved. I mean, if I were to look back at my life before I got saved at 24, I would have looked at myself and said, this guy's a clown. What's the matter with this guy? He's an idiot. You know, look at this. He's like, he's going to end up being one of those, you know, burdens on society or something. Now, I'm not, but that's not because, you know, I picked myself up by my bootstraps just because God saved me and then turned my life around. Otherwise, you know, I'd be one of the problem people in society, believe me. So, amen? So let's take an opportunity, at least, you know, where we have this time of Christmas, and ask God to open up an opportunity for us to share. Ask questions. Look, you're not going to have all the answers, but you can have questions. And the more questions you ask somebody in helping them tell you what they believe and why they believe it and the evidence for it, they may quickly realize maybe they're just not sure what they believe after all. And that's when you can share. Father, we thank you for the time tonight. We thank you for the message of reconciliation. And Lord, we thank you that you have brought us to the place we are in Christ. And I ask, Lord, that you would help us to be good witnesses, good ambassadors, Lord, through the Christmas time, and just take the opportunities, Lord, that you place in front of us. We thank you for your grace and your love. In Jesus' name, amen.